Okay. Welcome everyone to the webinar on free range radar level measurement by Endress+Hauser. In this session today, we will explore and talk about the innovative free range radar technology. My name is Oliver Cecchini, and I'm the product manager here at Endress+Hauser based in Sydney. And today I'm joined by two of my colleagues, Kia Chai, also called just Casey, who will lead us through the presentation, and which will be for approximately, let's say, about 30 minutes. Any questions you may have, you can post into the chat, and we will try to answer them at the end of the presentations. For this Q&A part, we also then joined by one further colleague of mine, and his name is Kieran Kuma. So before we continue, a quick overview on how to use GoToWebinar. To ask questions, please click on the chat tab and type your questions and hit send, and you will have access to any handouts from the handout sections. But what we also typically do, you will receive by tomorrow the presentations and also a recording of this webinar. So before I go through the agenda, I would like to mention that we have received already many questions prior to this webinar, which is great. So thank you for those. And considering the topics of those questions, we decided to reshape the content of the webinar slightly, which resulted actually in extending the amount of information we would like to bring to you today. So therefore, we actually decided to split the webinar into two parts in order to accommodate for the additional information. So in the first part today, we will cover the topics on radar technology basics. We look at beam angles, we look at radar designs, we look at different radar frequencies at some applications, and we also explore the topic on 80 gigahertz and why it sometimes actually doesn't work. So in the second part, which we are planning to hold next week, Thursday at exactly the same time at 2 p.m. Sydney time, the topics will be on heartbeat, on Bluetooth communication, and our wizards that are built into our devices. We look at some digitalization and obviously also on some question and answers. So we hope you understand that we also, or we're hoping that you understand that we had to, or joining, that we splitting this webinar into two sections. And we hope that you will be able to join us next week. And for the second session, you will get also an additional invitation sent to you by email. So with this now, I'm handing over to my colleague, Casey, and thank you very much. And talk to you in a little while. So over to you, Casey.
Typically, what you see here is actually, I would say, the spectrum for the electromagnetic waves. Across it, then you'll find that this goes all the way from your AC current in a telephone all the way up to gamma radiation that you have that's being used. We are using radar in that sense. When we talk about radar, we're looking at a small band of electromagnetic frequencies that operate between 1.5 gigahertz to approximately about 100 gigahertz. At this point of time on the market, you tend to find that there are a lot of different brands, a lot of different technologies that are about, but the most common use technology band frequencies right now, or in terms of, I would say, process radar, would be something like 1.5 gigahertz, which is typically used from 200 to about 1.5 megahertz or something like that, gigahertz. And they will be about using guided radar in that aspect. And then you will have things like 6 gigahertz radar, and then from there you have things like 8 to 10, 26 and 80 gigahertz. Now, if you've got a question on why did we use radar, In fact, radar started, I would say, close to the time I was born, which is the 1970s, where our submarine systems use radar on the large crude carriers to measure the amount of petroleum that was transported on our crude carriers at that time. And then from then on, it evolves from the base frequencies that we look at 6 gigahertz for your radar detection all the way to different frequencies like 8, 10, 26, and 8, and all that. So if you look at it from the chart itself, you'll find that the different frequencies radar have different wavelength. So the smaller the frequency radar, like for example, 6 gigahertz or 1.5 gigahertz, 1.5 gigahertz is about approximately 20 cm, and then 6 gigahertz radar, you go higher, maybe about 5 cm or that. And then when you hit the 80 gigahertz, the wavelength of the radar would come up to about 0.5 or 0.7 cm, right? So that is the relationship in which a frequency is directly inversely proportional to the wavelength in which the radar is being used. Now, having said that, why do we use radar? I'm sorry, we are sitting in Singapore, so the changing of that keyboard is a bit slower. Oliver, you might be able to help me just tap it down one. The next slide, please. Okay, sorry. Yeah, thanks, Oliver. I think there's something problem with the transmission. So, right. So when we deal with what's happening? Okay. So when we deal with different frequencies, how do we actually recognize what are we doing? Very simple. If you look at a 6 gigahertz radar, which is you find it on the lower left corner down here, you tend to find a 6 gigahertz radar has very big antenna. Typically, of course, electronics can be any size or depending on the make that you have, but the radar antenna frequencies will be a very huge thing. Anything about DN100, DN150, even DN200, you will find that it's the antenna size, the fringe size. Now, when you go to a higher frequency like 810 or 26 gigahertz, which is a much smaller one, you tend to find the antenna size will become smaller. So on the market, when you look at different frequencies, if you look into a tank, you find, okay, I got a big bulky antenna. Typically, you will have a lower frequency radar. When I get a higher frequency radar, you will find that you will get a small type of antenna. In that sense, like in this case, a 26 gigahertz, you can have this in the PTFE or a cone, or in this case, 80 gigahertz where the antenna size has dropped all the way down to about 1 cm or 2 cm wide on the antenna beam. Now, when you see that kind of size and antenna, it also tells us or limits to where I can use the antenna. Or the pictures you see are the different types of antennas or different types of installation that you have, or this particular interest is like this. Then the radar is mounted on the outside of the glass vessel. It's not even inside, or in this case, the radar itself is mounted on top of a plastic vessel. Now, when you've got such a thing where you have a plastic medium or a glass medium where the antenna could go into the vessel, it is possible to mount it outside the vessel and then just compensate for the change a little bit of how you mount it. But of course, in most cases, when we do installation, we have an antenna mounted in the vessel, which is very common, or antenna mounted on top of the silo. So in that aspect, this is the sum of the different ways that antenna can be done. A bit slower in the response. I'm not sorry for that. It's a bit slower, so they'll be a bit more patient with me. Typically, if I break apart an antenna, you will find that it makes up into the horn that you have, and it's connected with a cable to the high frequency module, and then convert to the electronics that convert the signal from the microwave, and then you output it. So actually, if you look at any antenna or any radar aspect that you find on the market, it will form these three or four main blocks. And the current technology that we're running, you either replace the antenna or you replace the central module of HF and the microelectronics, or you replace the output. Or in some installation, you change the whole radar sensor itself, because what they have done is that they combine everything. So you can see that later on in the different antenna types that we'll look at later. If I'm a bit too fast or a bit, you don't understand me, just drop the message in there or just type a message, please go down or something like that. Okay. Antenna, radar, microwave frequencies, a lot of time you've got this conspiracy theory saying that, okay, we can create cancer. So in order to evaluate, to eliminate these doubts and all that, if you look at the microwave oven, you typically have a 1 watt per cm, so you can cook a chicken with it. If you look at your Apple phone or your wire phone that you run about 2 watts or 0.01 watt per cm squared. Now, if you actually put two handphones together and then put an egg in between and then transmit continuously about 30 minutes, you can cook the egg. So don't play around with it. You know, some people like to talk too much on the phone with the phone directly to the head. You know, if you take a microgram or a heat wave of that, you actually heat up half your brain. So take note, you know, but you won't cook it, but just take note. All right, the radar itself, when we use it for process industry, we have to make sure that it is available for EX and EX applications. So in that aspect, you will find that the energy content that the radar and frequency emit is actually quite low. In that aspect, no matter how long you put the chicken in front of it, you really can't cook it. Now, to evaluate this, what we have done is that we work with a university in Karlsruhe, and that's the northern part, I would say northern central part of Germany, where we took cell culture and then we irradiate with all the different frequencies that we operate, like 6, 8, 10, you know, 226 and 80 degrees. So what we've done is that we take cell culture, we put the radar above it, and then we shine at it for about 3 years, just to prove that radar of that kind of energy content does not mutate or cause a problem onto that. Why we need to do that? Well, in actual fact, we do supply radar into a lot of life science and health industry and all that. So in terms of a bio growth, we have to make sure that the cell culture does not mutate, right? So that study we did more than about 5 to 10 years back, and we continuously do it because we have to do it for 3 years and 5 years until then. So every time we do a new frequency radar, which is the next one, which is going to come out maybe about 110 gigahertz or something like that, we need to redo this study again to prove to people that radar with that aspect does not cause cellular mutation. Right, so just to make yourself happy that, you know, you can stand in front of radar, you don't get create cancer and all that. But having said that, please don't, I would say, please don't stand in front of the huge radar dish that you find. Okay, next part of it, we will try to look at what is radar and the different frequencies that we run and the different effects of beam angle, and then what are the different antenna design that we look at. So very quickly, on radar and pulse frequency radar, We do have different kinds, and to have a very quick understanding of, or as a basic understanding of what radar technology is done, it's as simple as I mount the radar on top of a vessel or inside the vessel. We emit the radar frequency down from the antenna all the way to the liquid surface, and then this radar frequency, when it hit the liquid surface, will return back into the radar. Now, in that sense, To make it easier to understand, we know that the microwave propagate at the speed of light, and we know the tank empty distance, we know that the level of the distance, and we back calculate this. So when you're commissioning a radar actually for Endress+Hauser, think about having these three items, three values you have in the radar, like for example, the empty distance where you mount, all the way to the distance you want to measure, and to the level distance, because this is where you have your 0% and your 100%, right? And you need that actually to commission the radar itself. I did throw a challenge to our designer in the factory and says, can I just mount the radar? The radar learn everything by itself and give me a 4 to 20. Having said that, we haven't reached that kind of standard yet. So we still have to remember what is the empty distance, what's the full distance, and what is the range that you are using for the radar sensor, because it's not, I would say it's not a ChatGPT where you can learn and propagate the value by itself. Right. So what is available on the market? Now, in terms of measurement methods, I would say for process radars, you tend to have two different kinds. Let's work with what was being used in when you first got radar, and that would be FMCW, and that's what we call frequency modulated continuous wave. What is happening is that the transmitter emit a set of signal, or two sets of signal to be exact. One set of signal goes to the mixer, another set of signal goes out of the antenna, reflects and come back from there. And then in the mixer, what the mixer does is, as you understand, they compare one signal to the next signal, and then they get the difference in the signal. So when you deal with 6 GHz frequency radar, which is the earlier version, the delta frequency range should be sometimes less than 1 GHz. And then within the software functionality in the radar electronics, they do what we call Fourier transformation, where they take 1 GHz radar and then bring it down to like 20 kilohertz or 10 kilohertz. And then from there, they determine what is the distance. So in fact, almost all, I would say, software functionalities in a radar does that. So the next one that we look at is where we could do better electronics from the first generation in 1970s, where the electronics could be able to send out a pulse, come back onto the pulse, and then instead of doing a mixer, what it does is that it takes the time difference between the initial emitted pulse and the return pulse, and then compare that to the velocity in which the speed. Again, both, whether it is pulse radar and FMCW radar, use some sort of time dilation or Fourier transformation mathematics inside there, where they take, let's say, 26 GHz radar and then bring it down to the value of approximately 20 kilohertz. And then within electronics, they could actually determine whether it's a distance or whether it is the reflection surface on the signal. So to me, based upon whatever that's on the market, you will find that it is the software. Okay, hardware plays a part. The software part is where you get your accuracy and your statement. It doesn't really matter, in effect, whether you do FMCW or pulse radar. There was some customers of mine that in the past is, I should go for FMCW because it's more accurate. But actually, my answer to them is that it's not really a big issue, because the electronic person that designed electronics, whether it is a pulse radar or a FMCW radar, actually is very dependent on the electronics that you have in the market. And everything boils down to who writes the better software, right? So if you ask me whether I prefer pulse radar, I prefer FMCW radar, I would tell you each has its own plus and minus. At the end of the day, look at the experience in which the person uses the radar, and you find that there are many, many ways to get around the problems, right? Right, having said that, sorry, it's a bit too fast. Okay, when I deal with beam angle, the controls a bit problem. So when I deal with beam angles, right, if you go onto what we call on the technical information that you run, and everybody says, what's a beam angle? On this chart itself, what you find is that this is your emitting channel from here. We take this as where the antenna is. Your blue and red color lines are the electronic and magnetic fields that comes out from the radar. And typically, whenever somebody says beam angle, always know the beam angle means half the energy. So a beam angle does not mean all the energy in the radar is within the area in which emitted from the antenna. So if I draw this on the chart, and this is about 4 degrees on each side, so 50% of the energy falls within here, in this zone that you see here, and the rest of the 50% is actually here, and they're all wasted actually. So a lot of times on installation, when somebody comes back and asks, it says, please always remember when somebody tells you a beam angle of 8 degrees, but actually you're looking at only half the energy that's going out. So for this, which is a typical 26 GHz radar antenna, which is DN100, a beam angle of 8 degrees, you're only looking at this part here, where half the energy is going out from the antenna itself. Right. So a lot of times when you look at small print, fine print, just think about that. When we look at different beam angle and different frequencies, just very quick statement, a higher the frequency, the smaller the beam angle. And it means when you've got a smaller beam angle, the smaller your refraction surface. So when you got higher frequency, earlier we were saying the higher frequency radar tend to have smaller antenna and tend to have smaller process requirements. So just a very quick comparison, a 6 GHz radar with a DN150 antenna, you have a beam angle of 223 degrees. A 26 GHz radar with a DN80 antenna has a beam angle of 10 degrees. A 80 GHz radar has a beam angle of 3 degrees. So it means that you can have different applications using different antenna, using different frequencies, depending on what you're trying, what problem are you trying to solve in the process measurement that you're doing. So each has its own benefit. And of course, people say, okay, I got to go for 80 GHz because it's a smaller beam angle. There are reasons, yes, and there are reasons why I go for 860 GHz radar. To give you a very quick example, when I deal with, let's say, platform measuring of the wave and the tide, I will only use a 6 GHz radar because it's giving me a very wide beam angle that allows me to handle the variation of the waves in the sea. If I use 80 GHz radar in that aspect, then I have a little bit of a problem, right? So when I look at the same frequencies, let's assume in this case, I got a 26 GHz radar, I got different antennas, and typically with the same frequency, the smaller the antenna, I get a very large beam angle, and with a bigger antenna, I get 8 degrees on the beam angle. So a lot of times when we approach a problem, or we approach a situation or installation, we tend to go for the larger the antenna so that your beam angle is smaller. At the same time, your distance of measurement is much further. So there's also another dimension, because your beam angle is smaller, the energy that you focus within that beam is higher. It means that your radar measurement can go further. So a lot of times we tend to go for the larger, or any size that you give us, we tend to go for the larger beam antenna size so that we can extend the measurement range to be as far as we can, right? So that in a short is a very quick, I would say, relationship between that. And let's just look at also another aspect in terms of radar. And that aspect is, let's say, if I have the same antenna, then in this case, different frequencies, the 6 GHz radar tend to have a very big beam angle, 26 is smaller, and then 80 GHz also. And with that aspect, it also means, because I could spread out the energy a bit more, or I could spread out energy, concentrate the energy a bit higher, it's more easier to achieve accuracy with a higher frequency radar. In that aspect, if you look at the 6 GHz radar, a typical accuracy in a process on a very nice condition, you know, that will hit about 10 mm. On statement on paper, or in a very nice environment, you know, 26 GHz, I can hit an accuracy of 2 mm. Or with 80 GHz, I can hit the accuracy of 1 mm. So if you think about it, the higher, the smaller the beam angle, the more focus is the energy, the easier for us to achieve a higher accuracy radar. So in terms of whether you're doing custody or whether you're doing inventory control on the process, the higher frequency radar tend to give you a much better accuracy in that aspect. So you hit about 1 mm or plus minus 2 mm accurate. But if you think about it, in the process industry, you tend to be able to hit 5, 10 mm, or even 25 mm if you're lucky, because you got turbulence and you got settling. So when we look at all the different antennas, we look at different frequencies, you find that there's a wide, big variety of different antennas across the different market. We tend to be able to design different antennas for different installations. So on the first one, you see something that is like the second one, we have PTFE encapsulated antenna, enclosed antenna, a flat piece of antenna, or a horn antenna. So a lot of times when you look at different antennas, the design is also very limited or very constrained by the different frequencies that the antenna is using. So just a very quick one, when we do a classical antenna design, just pull the next page. Right. So this is a very compact type antenna. So on the picture that you see here, this type of antenna design is what we call an economical design, in the aspect if something goes wrong with this antenna, you just take it apart and throw it away. Because if you look at how this is done, you have the antenna chip which is embedded here, the horn which is built into the body with a metallized inside, and the front part here is encapsulated, and here it's actually fully ported so that it can hit the IP6866 type of specification. But this type of antenna, whether it is 26 years or 80 gigahertz, is possible because of the current chipset that's being run. So you could actually do it with a very small antenna. But again, like what we're saying, a smaller the antenna means the distance is smaller. Of course, you can normally use this up to 20 meters, 25 meters, that's not a problem. But the design in the aspect, you will find that on the outside, it doesn't appear that there is a horn, but actually the horn is totally embedded inside the antenna, and then you find that inside the body itself, and then you find the antenna body, which is mission down. Of course, this is just one construction. When you look at a different frequency radar itself, like in this case, this is a 6 gigahertz broad antenna design. So you do find that we need to make sure that there's process integrity. So from here, you get your process O-ring seal, which is on this part between the encapsulation, and then your molding on this part here, which is for, I would say, prevent process from going out into the electronics out in there. Then you get your helium test rig up to about 100 bar. Though on paper, this design may be about 40 bar, but in most of our design, with the German guys tend to overdo this, and then they tend to have a safety constraint about 10 times or something like 10 times or 20 times up to 100 bar and all that. So you get your welding specs, the spring washer to make sure that this is encapsulated so that you don't have a leak going in. And this is the part here where the antenna comes out into the rod and then processed out from the microwave itself. So this is a typical design in 6 gigahertz rod antenna design. Now, if you ask me why did we do that, it's because of application requirement. This is a typical 26 gigahertz horn antenna design. It doesn't matter how it looks like, whether it looks like this with a horn or whether it's a flat surface. There's always, I would say, the horn built in, right? And the horn built in this case, is the external metallic horn. But on the inside, you tend to have a PTFE cone, coupling, and then the O-ring structure. So typically in the order structure or order ring, we specify what's this O-ring, because this is the first defense against the process condition. And then the second defense is here where you do a welded coupling to get a higher, to prevent dangerous liquids from going out, right? You can do a gas type, gas welding on that. But when we do something like this, it may appear that there is no horn, but actually it's not true. If you notice, if you take apart this on the inside, the horn is here, right? You've got a noise induction layer, which is necessary, or else there will be a lot of unnecessary noise. Why? Because if you think carefully about the first chart that I show you, the emitting energy, where 50% will end up inside here. So that will create a lot of noise. You need to really get this dampler inside there, and you get your snap ring. So this design is what we do for, I would say, a condensation type, because your PTFE horn is one whole piece, fits directly into the enclosed horn, and then it prevents, I would say, condensation on the external layer or something. And of course, the safety features of your O-ring and your coupling on that. So this is a typical, I would say, 26 gigahertz. Now, if I look at the 80 gigahertz design, again, earlier when we discussed, we look at 80 gigahertz, we're looking at very, very small wavelength. So it means that your antenna became so small, it's just here. It's about, I would say, 2 cm approximately. And this shape here is all that you need to form the antenna. The next design that will come in is for 120 gigahertz, but then we are not discussing that here. So you have your radar chip, which is embedded, your waveguide, you see this long, long little type, which used to act as your coupling. And then here becomes your antenna, which is this small little horn down here. to go into your PTF in it. So in this case, this design for 80 gigahertz either allow you to go to about 40 meters or something like that. And then with this design, maybe about 25 to 30 meters. So in all the radar antenna designs, you will get your radar chip, your encapsulation, your process seal, and your built-in horn. So very quickly, that will give you a rough idea of how antenna designs are being done and where the problems will happen. Because if you think about it, how we design the antenna means where the problem will happen, or we try to design the antenna so to solve certain problems. Now, in this case, when you see the 80 gigahertz design, what we're trying to do is to prevent condensation. So you get this drip off and this part here, which is part of the design aspect, or in this like this. So in this case, when you're dealing with PTFE encapsulation, you can practically plug this into a sulfuric acid tank or into a hydrochloric acid tank. And then as long as it doesn't destroy the PVDF too much, you will be able to use it in that kind of application, right? So this is just one aspect. Typically, when we deal with horn and horn antennas, we tend to find that different application, different frequencies, different use. Let's try to look at some of them very quickly. We do supply horns, antennas into various industries. So you can see them from chemical tanks to silos, to conveyor belts, to flour silos, to ash silos, to even lift stations, sludge blankets, and sludge silos. So as Endress+Hauser, as a company, we supply to almost all different vessels, different things, and they tend to have different aspects in terms of how they are used, right? So having said that, when we design radar, we need to take care of a lot of things. We need to take care of turbulent surfaces, we need to take care of extreme temperatures, we need to take care of dust, we need to take care of media and foam. So it's a bit difficult to design a one ring. If you're familiar with the law of rings, it's impossible to have one ring to rule everybody. So with that aspect, there are a lot of different considerations that we do, and we intend to try to find solutions that are able to cater to all these mediums that you're talking about, right? Having come to that, okay. I think I'll hand to Oliver.
Thank you, Casey. Just a little break in between, and to for everyone to just to be engaged a little bit. So for us, it's always important to improve our services to everyone, obviously, so that we continue the presentation just quickly after this. We hope you don't mind answering just a few, one question, and which is multiple choices are provided. This would help us immensely. Also, maybe in answering some of these answers, depending on or how they answered on the next slides, hopefully we'll be able to engage in some of these. So I don't mind if you don't if you're okay to answer these poll questions. Jason, you can put a poll in. Okay, so thank you very much. I think the poll is true. Unfortunately, I can't see the result at the moment. Bear with me 1 second. Okay, so the majority actually of the votes were on, or the most votes were on device performance. So the majority of the importance lies on the performance of the device, which is quite interesting. So which actually is quite good, because we get to this in the next few slides. So for this, I'm going to pass back on to Casey again. Thank you, Casey.
Right, I'll go to the
next slide.
Right, so when we design different frequencies, there's a lot of different things that we consider. But in order to, there are too many considerations. So what we've done is that we try to limit a few things and to point out certain things that you tend to be able to look at. Radar, process radar at this point of time has a temperature limit of approximately, I would say, minus 196 degrees C up to 450 degrees C. And at this point of time, most of the designs that you have on the market will be from vacuum to about 400 bar. So it already encompasses a lot within the process industries. But when I deal with different frequencies, like for example, a guided radar, we normally take a guided radar. If you ask me, I would say a guided radar, if you've got interface, that's my first choice, typically in a bypass and all that. And I would say use that, because a lot of times you're in a guided radar, you can compensate the gas phase for it, and then that allows you to handle the variation of dielectric constant medium variation. Like for example, in steam, in bypass, you tend to have a shift in the dielectric value with steam gas. And then from there, you are able to use a gas-based compensation to correct for that. It's actually, for guided radar, this is the best application in bypass and against foam and low dielectric medium. In 6 GHz, typically, it's one of the best solutions that I could think of for long steering wheel applications. And earlier we did say that 6 GHz has a very wide beam angle, which means that they are actually the best for turbulent surfaces and all that. So if you give me a long steering wheel and you said I don't want to have contact radar, then I will automatically use a 6 GHz radar. If I'm dealing with 26 GHz radar, because they have been on the market for a very, very long time, I would say close to about 15, 20 years or something like that. And they are the most widely used at this point of time. And in most solvents, I would tend to swing towards 26 GHz radar. But 80 GHz radar at this point of time has the smallest process connection. It's about 3/4 inch or 50 mm or 70, 80 mm, smaller than that, 50 mm, 40 mm or something like that. It has, at this point of time, the largest measurement range. And if your application is a bit fast, then typically almost 90% of all application at this point of time can be solved with 80 GHz radar. So that's just typically we as a supplier or across the different frequencies that we're running, that we see how the industry is progressing. Now, there are different things that we normally use, and we normally use for different applications. So a lot of times we, as a supplier, or as a manufacturer for the different frequencies of the radar, we tend to swing between guided radar, 6 GHz radar, 26 or 80 GHz radar. To give you an example, if you're dealing with ethylene oxide, or ethylene oxide as a chemical, I would normally only use a 6 GHz radar or a 1 GHz radar, and I would totally avoid the 80 and 26 GHz radar. So this got to do with a lot of where you have used them, and I would say that we do have quite a lot of experience in dealing with all the different aspects, and of course we do learn from our own mistakes. I can honestly tell you, we do learn from quite a lot of mistakes when we first started doing radar, maybe 20, 30 years back, right? And if you look at the new block on the family, I think this is going to be an old block in a few months' time. The new block on the new kit on the block for us is an 80 gigahertz radar, which is the B version at this point of time. The 60 gigahertz radar, 80 came out a few years back, but the B version is the current version that we run on this, where we do different size, different display, different electronics. I think for more details, you can talk to the guys, our sales guys or our marketing guys in Australia who will help you with that, right? So you tend to find that the design change and all that we're doing. What's happening? Sorry, the thing swap again. In terms of, slide's not moving again. Sorry about that. Okay, in terms of where we use radar and all that, we tend to have guides within our company that we say, okay, when we do a 6 years radar, if I do a 6 years radar, if I got a steering wheel, the green means I can use a 6 gigahertz, I can use a 26 gigahertz, or I can use a 3-inch antenna on it. So for us, when we do this selection, we do based on process types, and we do based on frequency types and all the comments on all that. So if you give us a choice, I will process vessel, we will check what's the distance that we can run. Either we use a 6 gigahertz radar, a 26 or 80 gigahertz radar. If I do a very small tank, then typically the first choice for us would be a 80 gigahertz radar. If I do a small process connection, I can do with 80 gigahertz radar or threaded version, or I can do a 80 gigahertz radar travel or 6 gigahertz radar. So this guide for us within our company, we can do that. So we have different types of things, and this column here that says ammonia. So when I deal with ammonia or ammonia installation, we said the best choice is just go with a guided radar. There are other issues at hand in the ammonia, because ammonia actually penetrates quite a lot of O-ring and O-ring substances. So we would tend to use ammonia because the rest of the frequencies tend to run into other problems, especially when you deal with this kind of liquids, right? When you got absorption issue or 80 gigahertz absorption, then we tend to avoid them based on what other applications that you run. So we build up the tables like this, where based upon all the installations that we run, we tend to find a proper solution or a valid solution that we could do in the application, right? So this guide, you can actually find it you can check with Australian guys, they can normally release it and then there's not a problem, right? It's a bit fast, sorry. So in terms of liquid influences and applications, whether it is absorption value, media value, or in this case in solids, where we're dealing with floor silos, conveyor belts, we tend to say, okay, you can run between the 6 gigahertz, you can run 80 gigahertz. If you're a crusher, you can do either both, right? So there are a lot of things inside there that we use. Like for example, in solids, where I got extreme dust, I do have improved performance on the 80 gigahertz B version. And whether do I have high pressure, I can run it up to 450 degrees also, right? If you have a doubt, I would say, do a self-help yourself, just go to online, go on to Endress+Hauser, you can use that web page and all that. Go into there, useendress.com, where you could go in on the product selection, whether you run it from an industry specific or whether you run it off a product specific, you can be able to use that to streamline the selection that we put in. So to do that, what we've done is that we take that chart that you see earlier on, and then we automate it with a couple of questions that you could do on applications, and then use that to help you on the selection. It's a bit chunky at this point in time, but I think that's one of the better ways around it. So very quickly on all the different applications. So this is a typical, I would say, alkaline tank and a buffer vessel. So about 3 meters on a plastic vessel and tank. This is a relatively old radar that we have, 26 gigahertz and 6 gigahertz. Right, with probably about the NAT pipe height. You'll find that on the curve itself for this 26 gigahertz radar, this is your reflection peak. And when our guys step in to look at this, it says, okay, this is a very easy thing to do because there's not a lot of obstacles inside there. It's perfectly clean. There's only one rod in between and Now, this is a very easy application in a sense, right? Whether it's a plastic tank or a wooden plank on top, you can still use it. Typical. This is something that is a bit more difficult. We tend to use this with either 26 gears or 80 gears. In this case, this is a three-stage agitator. You can see the radar here, the central agitator down here. And when you took a picture on this side, this is the kind of agitator that you have running here. So in this, I would say with a copper sulfate, oxalic acid, sulfuric acid type, you know, about 4 or 5 meters, it's not an issue really to do a three-stage agitator. The most number of agitator stage that I think we have done, I would say, and work very, very well, would be something close to a five-stage agitator. If you're running this kind of blades, it's not really a problem. But if you're actually doing chocolate, and if you know about chocolate manufacturing, the agitator that you run, which is a scraper blade that scrapes the wall of the tank, then you may have a problem using a three-stage radar because the blades are huge, right? But again, it's something that you can try if you want. You can test it out with a demo unit or something like that. But in most cases, our guys should be able to access this and say, okay, if I mount it off the site, then I will avoid the agitator blade, right? Because this is off-site from there, maybe somewhere around here, right? We will avoid the agitator blade. So even if the blade sweeps underneath the radar, we were able to do some software compensation. This is a very typical application in the hopper for clinker powder. So this is not a big one. It's about 8 meters or something like that, where you mount it off the side down here so you can see the clinker vessel below. And the radar antenna radar is mounted inside with horn inside. In this case, you find that there's a lot of issue on dust and geometry. So a lot of times when I see this kind of applications, our guys will ask you quite a lot of questions. It says, how is your cross tie rods on the inside? You know, whether you can avoid it. In some of the installations like this, we could avoid. In some installations, if your mounting location is here and then your tie rod just go below directly, I would say forget it, right? So we'll have to find a different way to do the installation. So a lot of times, think about it. When you mount the radar, it must be able to see a clear pathway from the top down. So in this case, you get your tie rods like this, and this is based upon older 26 gigahertz frequency radar. And I run it with 80 gigahertz radar, and I do this because your beam angle is made smaller. So with that aspect, you may be able to get an 80 gigahertz radar to work, or you may be able to get a 26 gigahertz radar to work, right? So again, this always depends on how your installation looks like. In this one, it's typically a 6 or 26 gigahertz radar. You see these tanks here, they are FRP tanks, so fiber reinforced carbon. And the radar itself will mount directly on the outside of the vessel, right? You can be a fiberglass reinforced plastic. One of the things that I like about this installation is because when you deal with sulfuric acid and you deal with nitric acid, and the guys are filling in the tanks every now and then, if you have the radar inside there, you've got to do a troubleshooting on the radar. You've got to open up the tank, drain out the tank. But in this kind of installation where I mount the radar on the outside of the tank, and I can totally manage the maintenance of the system, right? If you look at this radar size, this is our very old radar. So we've been doing this for many, many years. I would say this is like a 15 to 20 years old radar. Aspect on the picture, right? So it is entirely possible to mount the radar outside the plastic vessel so that you don't actually have to open up the manhole and you can do the maintenance quite easily. The only problem that we encounter over the years is that if the dust layer build up here, you've got to try to clean it up, you know. But in most cases, most of the plants, that's not really a very big problem. So the maintenance wise in that aspect is much better compared to you mounting the radar inside the vessel. In the past, we normally said, you know, your radar should not be mounted in the exact center of the vessel. I think that is no longer an issue. As long as your radar mounting path, like in this case, if I mount it here or I mount it here, I totally avoid the coils that you see here based upon either the beam angle calculation or based upon your mounting location and all that, then we tend to be able to measure directly into this layer, right? So unless you've got crossbar or you've got a lot of different things inside there, anything that's mounted here, this zone would normally be possible to measure the sensor. In the past, we normally say don't mount it in the center, but that is no longer valid because with the software that you run these days, this is not a problem at all, right? So this is another type of applications that we run. It's typical in sewage lines and rainwater flood controls. You tend to find sewage pump stations in city areas or build up areas, construction, where the vessels or the sewage control lines can be anything up to about 6 to 30 meters in height. So in that aspect, when we mount a sensor like this, we have to avoid all these tanks and all that below. So choose a proper mounting location so that your radar has a direct path of light or path of microwave that can see the surface and reflect. It is possible in this case, like for example, we offset that noise that comes in from all these obstacles by just do a map of it, so the software can actually handle it. As long as your radar curve goes above the noise, not really a problem, right? There are instances that we've done this exactly where I mount this directly on top of the platform here. Now, this type of platform, if it's a grating platform, you know, those metal grates that has slits and cut slits in there, and the grates are typically have a width of about 2 cm or 3 cm or something like that, where people can step on top. Now, we have done installation where this is just mounted on top of the metal platform. And with the metal platform, we don't cut a hole in the platform. So that is totally possible. If you have an issue, just consult the guys and they can just do a very quick trial where they mount the sensor directly on top here. And the radar will go through the grating platform below. Now, if you've got two layers of grating platform, that's not possible. If you only got one single layer, I can just mount this here and the radar will go through the platform, right? The metal platform. Provided there are slits, grating slits that you can shine through, and then you can measure below without cutting the platform itself, right? The range will be a bit less, but then normally it will be less mechanical work for you, right? In terms of cement silos, at current technology that we run on 80 gigahertz, we can probably hit about 40, 50 meters. And normally in the cement line, we tend to run it with air perch directly where if there's a condensation or there are some issues on cement sticking onto the antenna, we tend to do an air perch and then remove the perch lines directly. Right. There are certain pitfalls to avoid. If I'm dealing with a 1 gigahertz radar, we tend to take note of what we call process medium lateral force, where if you've got agitation, the agitation will push the radar or the rod sideways. It is possible to calculate this lateral force versus the height of the vessel. So just take note about that. If not, then you got to do a steering well. One of the other things that somebody may not look at is when you do a guided radar, you need to take care of pull force. What is pull force? Pull force is, let's say, for example, if you've got a guided radar in the vessel, and when your process discharge, the process discharge medium will pull the rod down into the process. And if this pull force is too big, it will collapse your roof. So in most cases, just take note of things like this. Our guys will normally advise that, right? When I do a 6 gigahertz radar, we tend to have a lower measurement range because your beam angle is wider, your range is smaller, and your process connections tend to be much larger. In terms of 80 gigahertz, the biggest pitfall that I can think of is ammonia. We did learn our lesson when we first did 26 gigahertz into a digester vessel, and we couldn't figure out why it didn't work. Then we realized that ammonia is absorbing 26 gigahertz, and that's about 20, 30 years back then we got this. So anytime that I see ammonia, automatically I jump to a 1 gigahertz guided radar. When I deal with 80 gigahertz radar, we also have our lessons where there are different absorption medium like acetone, ketone, and dipolar solvents. In that aspect, when I'm dealing with 80 gigahertz radar, I tend to think and see, is my solvent have a di double bond, like an oxygen double bond in acetone or ketone, because the gas phase tend to absorb 80 gigahertz. So if you think carefully, within free space radar, you tend not to do interface. I don't use free space radar for interface. I use a guided radar. And there are two other things like nozzles having heating requirements. So if you condensation nozzle, sometimes we say, okay, either you heat up the nozzle or heat trace the nozzle. If not, then you got to think of how to heat the horn. Right? There are other things like, for example, top and bottom dead zone, right? Top and bottom dead zone is, I wouldn't say it's really a dead zone. I would say it is more of where the sensor cannot measure. Right. So let's look at very quickly what is acetone issue with 80 or 26 gigahertz radar, but typically 80 gigahertz radar. This is acetone tank, where in a static state, you can see this nice, beautiful reflection curve. So, hey, the sensor works fine. Right? But when we start filling up the vessel with acetone from the top down, and the gas phase starts appearing on the acetone on the top layer, during the filling side, this signal totally disappear. And even after 30 minutes, unless your gas phase has totally reabsorbed back into the water layer, your output signal from the radar became this. So in our aspect, we said, okay, let's just totally avoid it. Let's not even use 80 gigahertz in acetone environment or ketone type environment, where you have sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. So why, from the point of engineering or from point of application wise, we would just say forget it, right? Even there's a small chance of during filling or non during filling, or in most cases it works. I said, okay, let's not take the risk, because when you put in certain things, you take out certain things, you get a problem later on, right? What about bottom dead zone? Actually, I wouldn't say it is a dead zone, right? If you look at a dielectric value and the reflection of the curve from here, every technical information you see earlier, this smaller part on this part that says, okay, it doesn't work very well. But actually what's happening is that the radar goes to the tank, it hits the level, it hits the bottom, it reflects here and it reflects here. So if this peak of reflection becomes higher and higher, you get your level measurement. So when you have a 26 gigahertz and I have an 80 gigahertz, this peak, this thickness in the layer becomes smaller and smaller. So what it means is that the higher dielectric value, like water, sulfuric acid, and all that, will reflect better. So when it reflects better, this bottom to the first layer will tend to be thinner. So if you look into the technical information, in most cases across almost all the manufacturers, they have this value and says this bottom area is 200 to maybe 300 value. So this thickness layer, typically when you do a 6 gigahertz radar, you will find that this thickness layer needs about 250 to 300, right? But when you do a higher frequency radar, 26 gigahertz radar or 80 gigahertz radar, this thickness value become smaller and smaller, where the first reflection peak from this becomes higher. So typically I would say on the 6 gigahertz radar, you're looking about 300 mm as a ballpark for oil. And then a 26 gigahertz radar, you're looking at something about 125 to 150 mm. For 80 gigahertz radar, you're looking at close to about 60 or 80 mm. So it's not that you can reflect very well. You need that layer here before the radar can recognize that there is liquid in the tank. So just very quickly, just take note of this so-called dead zone type application, right? I think with that, I think I got to, I already take up almost 1 hour. Back to you, Oliver.
All right, okay. Thank you very much, Casey. It's, yes, sorry, we've gone slightly over time, but I think it was worthwhile it. So, we have quickly some questions in the chat. Unfortunately, we have quite a few questions. Unfortunately, we won't be able to answer them all, obviously, but we will ensure we will answer them back to you by email. So one question is, where would you use a radar in a or which type of radar would you, or frequency would you use in a turbulent environment? So I think that was answered actually on the slide 25, which is a 6 gigahertz radar for turbulent surfaces, but also in consideration, obviously, what is the type of medium, what is the construction of the tank, what is the is there any obstacles, etc., in the tank? Another question is, does Endress have a radar level instrument with cloud connection? Yes, we do. We have a model, it's called FWR30, which is connects to our Endress and ours in Atelian cloud with a battery lifetime between 10-15 years. But actually, as mentioned, there will be a second part of this webinar, and this will be covered in this webinar. So for this, I'm going to call the end of this webinar, and mentioning again, the second session will be next week on Thursday at 2 p.m. Sydney time, so same time as today. You all will get an invite for it, and I hope you can all make it again. And my apologies again for the short notice that we split it into sessions, but again, because of the high amount of questions and the type of questions, we figured we need to extend some of the content of the webinar. So with this, I thank you very much. I wish you a nice rest of the day, and thanks again for joining, and hopefully see you next week. And thank you again, KC and Kieran. Thank you very much, and goodbye.